Welcome to another episode of our mini podcast, I Built a Company That Makes a Difference by B1. Here we talk to founders of sustainable businesses to get their takes on how and why they started their companies and the lessons that they've learned along the way. My guest today is Savan Anderson, the founder of Aya Paper Co., which is a sustainable stationery brand that creates greeting cards and gifts to help everyone celebrate more authentically. Savan, thank you so much for joining us. Your cards and your gifts, I was just on your website, they are beautiful. And beyond that, today I really want to dive into how you built this company, how you went from zero to where you are today, as well as some bigger picture topics that I would love to talk about with you, such as climate change and how climate change is disproportionately affecting communities of color around the country and around the world. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to have this conversation. It's not often that I get to speak specifically about sustainability and business specifically in regards to communities of color. So this is going to be really exciting for me.
Ooh, okay. So let's just start from as far back as you want to start. Talk to us about yourself and your background. Who was Savan?
Yes. So I am a Newark native. That is a very important part of my identity. Third generation Newark native. That's where I still work from, where I live. I actually am right now living in the same house that I grew up in. So I'm definitely a hometown girl. What else about me? I'm a Capricorn, which is really important to me. Both of my parents are also Capricorn. So I'm very focused and ambitious. And my fiance is a Capricorn. So yes, we're very grounded over here. What else about me? I'm a mom. In addition to being a founder, I became a mom halfway through my journey as an entrepreneur, actually. So that's been a really important part of how my business practices, I think, have evolved and how my role as an entrepreneur has changed over the 4.5 years that I've been doing this. I started this company in the summer of 2019. I'm a graphic designer by trade. That's what I did before I started this business. And it was kind of part of my motivating factor to do it. I was doing a lot of freelance client work for a while, and I started to get a little uninspired by that. And also, I wasn't enjoying the practice as much of, you know, I'm a very creative person, but having to work within the confines of a project for someone else that once it was finished, I had no control over. So creating my own company where I could design something once and then produce things that people could have access to at an accessible cost was really important to me. So that's why I decided to create greeting cards as the next step in my creative practice.
So how did you, because that is... I'm a marketer before being an entrepreneur, and I feel like there are 1,000 tiny ways that that is super useful and can drive business from the top that I discover every single day, or I'm reminded every single day. I feel the same about a skill set based around graphic design and visual design. And how did you, so there are lots of ways that you could have spun that off. There are lots of ways that you could, I mean, you could have gone into children's books illustration. I mean, there's so many things that you could have. What was the leap between, all right, this is what I'm doing. I'm freelancing right now doing this. This is my kind of core expertise to greeting cards.
So when I started Aya Paper Co., I was doing freelance in addition to a full-time job. So I was a graphic designer and digital coordinator at an art museum in New York. And in that role, it was a very small communications team and I was the only designer there. So I was doing a lot of work, just like churning out a lot of projects all of the time. But at the same time, I was also working very closely with people who were career visual artists. And that was very inspiring for me to see people who had almost the ultimate freedom to create whatever it is that they wanted. But I also saw kind of some of the struggles of that, where, you know, your livelihood is based on if people want to buy this piece of art that you've worked on for, you know, months or sometimes years. And sometimes, you know, you get one big payout and then you have to wait a long time for the next one. So I was seeing how unsustainable it was for some career artists to make a living. But also at the same time, seeing the great impact of art and how it transforms how we see ourselves, how we see the world. And I wanted to do that. You know, I didn't see myself as a career artist at the time. I think that some people who are graphic designers see themselves as artists. Sometimes there's an overlap, but a lot of times there's a big gap between the two. So my experience as a graphic designer working at an art museum helped me to kind of merge those things and start to see myself as more of an artist and realizing that, okay, if I took more of the creative control back into this and didn't think of myself as a designer for the sake of, you know, creating a project for someone else, but what is it that I want to create? What am I passionate about? What is something that I think could have a positive impact on the world? What would that look like? And for me, greeting cards was the first thing that came to me because it's something that has always been important to me to see myself represented. Growing up, I always loved getting greeting cards. There's a really great video that my dad showed me recently of me after my fifth birthday party at home, opening up all of my birthday cards. And at this point, I couldn't really read, but I was so excited to open them and just, you know, explain what I saw and just like, you know, seeing who it was from. So that experience of getting greeting cards has always been really important to me growing up. So as an artist, it was like, okay, this is something that I can do that will have a big impact because I know the impact that it has on me when I open up a great greeting card. And conversely, I also know the feeling that I have when I go in a greeting card aisle and I don't see anything that looks or sounds like me. So that kind of dichotomy is what made me want to solve that problem. Like, okay, I want people to feel as good as I feel when I open up a great greeting card that someone wrote a really sentimental message to me. And I want it to be more accessible. Like we should all be able to have that feeling and not feel like we're not being represented in this industry. So yeah, that was a long drawn out answer, I think. But yeah, that's how I kind of made that shift from just a graphic designer into the founder of this company that is all about making people feel seen.
So you design all of your products?
I don't design all of them. So that's another thing that was really important to me is to recognize the diversity of the Black experience and that, you know, I cannot myself provide that representation for everyone. So I do a lot of the designs, but I'll also work with a team of other Black women designers, many of them people that I know. So people who, one of our designers is someone who was an intern for me when I was a designer at the art museum. Another person is someone who I just met online who was a really talented designer. Someone else originally was doing social media marketing for me. And I found out that she was a great designer. So she started creating some designs for us. So it's a really great community effort to create all these designs. So I usually identify myself as the founder and the creative director so that people understand that, you know, it's not all of my designs only, but I do have the creative vision to bring all of this together. And that's something that I always want to do is always use my platform and my business to give more opportunities to other Black women designers, because I know how difficult it is to kind of break into this industry and to get your products to be seen and to kind of build that industry authority and to be able to say, this art print that I made was displayed in Kohl's. Like that can mean a lot for a designer to get certain opportunities to be able to, you know, make what they're worth. So that's a really important part of my values when it comes to running the business.
So was freelancing, because you were working a lot, so you had a yes. full-time job and you were freelancing. Did the fact that you were freelancing make it easier or make it maybe less daunting to translate this into a full-time business because you were already kind of doing your business on the side, which is what freelancing is?
Right. Sure. I think that was probably a part of it that made it less daunting is because I was already doing some freelance work. But I think the main contributing factor to not feeling daunting is that I come from an entrepreneurial family. So having my own business never felt like something that was too far-fetched. My dad has had his own business since I was maybe 7, that I watched him, you know, develop and grow to. At one point it was a side job, but then he turned into his full-time job that he was able to purchase homes and send me and my brother to school and all these great things. So that's one thing. My aunt is also an entrepreneur. She has her own daycare center. I grew up hearing about my I think this is my great great uncles. They had a hotel here in Newark that was the only hotel for Black people to go to at a point. So I think this was during the 40s. They had a hotel called Coleman Hotel, and all the Black musicians, when they came to this area to New York to perform, they would stay there because they couldn't stay at the other ones. They also had a car dealership, a bar, I think. So, you know, hearing these stories about my family history and seeing how people were creative, but also ambitious enough to start their own businesses, all kind of inspired me. And even going, thinking further back, I come from a family of sharecroppers in North Carolina. And that is a business in and of itself. You know, it was kind of the first way that Black people in this country were able to start their own businesses and try to find some economic independence. So I think that knowing all of that about my history and where I came from gave me some of that confidence and comfort with taking that risk on myself.
For sure, knowing that in your own family, it's been done before many, many times. Mm-hmm. That must give a lot of confidence. Talking about how the sustainability aspect comes into play.
Yes. So when I started the company, that was 2019. I was 2 years out of college at that point. But throughout my time living in New York, that was when I started to understand or even just, you know, be immersed in the world of sustainability. Growing up here in Newark, it wasn't something that was really talked about. It wasn't a common discussion. I just knew my life and this is what it is. You know, we never really had conversations about climate change. Any, like, we had plants in my house and, you know, I knew about like gardening and things like that in a very vague sense, but it wasn't something that was intimate or close to me. But while living in New York, I started to be exposed to a different type of community of Black women specifically that were working in sustainability. Two of the people that I always have to credit are Dominique Drakeford and Whitney McGuire. They are the founders of Sustainable Brooklyn. And I got connected with them throughout my time living here in New York and started to learn a lot more about how climate change is disproportionately impacting communities of color. And I kind of got into a deep dive and started realizing like how many of the ways that the conditions that I experienced growing up were not the norm. So like, you know, the fact that when I wanted to go to the park growing up, my dad would never take me to the park in our neighborhood. We had to drive out to the suburbs to go to a good park that was, you know, safe for us to be in. Realizing how common asthma was in my classmates and my family, and that that's not something that is the normal rate for other communities, but it does happen in urban populations because of the chemical pollution that's happening here, because of all the trucks that are routed through our neighborhoods, like so many factors that I was not thinking of. I just took it as the normal conditions of my life. So it was at this point when I'm starting to realize like, okay, the way that, you know, I've experienced my community growing up is different from how people who are not Black and who are not living in low economic neighborhoods are experiencing their world. And it's having these really great impacts that we're not even talking about. You know, we just think that asthma is a part of life. We just think that, you know, not having trees on your street is a part of life. We think that not having access to, you know, a place to go hike and be in nature or like a garden is just, that's normal. So as I was unlearning all these things, I was thinking about, so this was in the back of my mind when I'm creating this company. And I'm like, okay, so in addition to trying to provide representation, I also want to make sure that we're not contributing to all of these things. You know, I don't want to be furthering the pollution and the climate change that business is really a part of. You know, I think that that's one of the common things that we hear in a lot of conversations about the balance between independent action and community action and government action, like who's responsible here. And there's so many layers to it. So as I was venturing, well, as I was starting this venture to be an entrepreneur, I took on that responsibility of knowing that, you know, what I've been doing individually as a person is one thing, but how I'm going to run this business and thinking about this business as, even though it's a small one right now, my goal is for it to grow and to have a bigger impact. So I have to start now with thinking about the sustainability so that as I grow, it's already ingrained into the way that we do things so that it's not as much of a challenge. It's just how we do things. Like we're always going to be considerate of the product life cycle. Where is this going to end up? We're always going to be considerate of how we're sourcing things. Is this the most ethical option? How are we shipping things? Like thinking about it from top to bottom at the very beginning has been super helpful for me to continue with those sustainable practices today, now almost 5 years in.
That's super interesting. And it gets me thinking about an industry that I have absolutely no idea about, which is stationery and greeting cards. So when I think about an industry like this, just scanning whatever common knowledge I would have, I think, okay, this must be largely dominated by, you know, a couple big companies. Yes. Mm-hmm. But what are, everyone is craving, I mean, we hear stories about this all of the time on B1, shoppers, consumers are craving different options, alternatives. Yes. To big box, big brands, mm-hmm. and they like things that are representative, they like things that are inclusive, they like right. things that are local, and they like things that are within reach, that mean something. Mm-hmm. What have you found? Can you describe for all of us who are not as intimately familiar right. with this industry as you are, what it is like, just from a an inside, telling us on the outside what this is like.
Right. I think that, so a lot of the What you just said is kind of it. You know, when you walk into the greeting card aisle at any store, it kind of tells its own story. Like you said, for one, it's dominated by a very few big conglomerates: Hallmark, American Greetings, Carlton, Papyrus. You know, these are the big paper stores, and a lot of them have even started to combine. Like, I think Carlton is a part of American Greetings now. So there are a few very big companies that make up the majority of the industry, and that they don't prioritize representation and diversity. It's not a priority for them unless it's like Black History Month. Or, you know, they might have a little one aisle, not even an aisle, one section in the aisle dedicated for, you know, mahogany. You know, everyone knows mahogany. That's the one Black focused collection by Hallmark. But don't we deserve more than just that? Like you said, people want options. Why are we restricted to only this one subset? So that's the main thing. When it comes to, you know, the big picture of the industry, it's mostly dominated by a few big players, and those few big players, they will have a small kind of sub-brand dedicated to Black community. But most times it's limited and kind of the theme even. So like mahogany, I always tell people that mahogany is a very religious collection. Almost every card has a spiritual undertone, like a scripture in it. And that's not the full Black experience. You know, I think that a lot of the ways that these big companies portray their quote unquote Black collections says a lot about the I guess like their disconnection from our lived experiences. You know, when you have people who are not living in the Black community, who are not, you know, living this experience, it's very easy for them to say, okay, this checks the box for, you know, Black Christians over 40, done, and not thinking about anyone else. So that's kind of where I guess that's my idea of the competitive landscape when it comes to who is serving our specific demographic. And on the other side of, you know, these big companies are lots of small independent makers. So the type of people who you see who are selling cards on like Etsy, people who are my peers who, you know, they have their own D2C channels, but they're also maybe selling, you know, to home, they might be like licensing their designs to a Hallmark, or they may be doing a small collection for Target or something like that. So yeah, on the other side of the big companies, we have all these small independent makers, some of them a little bit smaller than Aya Paper Co., some of them around the same size as us. And the thing that I really love about that is that there's so much room for all of us to exist. I'm actually very good. I'm connected with a lot of people who are in this industry along with me. And I really like that there's not a big spirit of competition. It's more so we want to see help each other succeed because we
Well,
realize
I
that there's
love
so
that
much
you just
room.
called them peers rather than competitors.
Yes, they are my peers, you know, and I think that just using that name alone, it brings in a sense of respect for what each other is doing. Because there's so much, like my thing is the Black experience is so nuanced. It's so nuanced. Like I came across people always ask me, like, oh, do you have any cards about Islam for Eid? And I'm like, you know, I'm not Muslim and we don't really do religious things, but I've always wanted to, you know, find other people who I can refer them to because like I don't have to do everything. I think the best thing about my approach to business is being very specific about who you're serving. And if you're not serving them, that's okay. We don't have to be greedy and try to get everybody, you know, but there's other people in this industry that we can refer to. So that's the thing that I think is really unique about the stationery industry, that even though there are those few big players, there's also so much room kind of, I guess, at the bottom, you know, that 10% of everyone else, there's so many of us there that it gives people a lot of options, but it's really about the accessibility. That's the piece that I think that, you know, we don't have when it comes to the big competitors. So like when you go in Walgreens or Target, you'll only see Hallmark and American Greetings, for example. So it's hard for us to get that shelf space. And that's how people consume cards. Most people, they want to go into the store at the last minute and go and get the card. So that's been our next big hurdle, is trying to figure out how to make our design more accessible so that Black folks, when they have a birthday, when they have like a last minute congratulations, they can just go in the store and get it. They don't have to have the weeks long foresight to remember to go and buy it on the website to get it shipped to them, which I'm so grateful that people do that. People will literally go on our website and buy one card for one occasion. Or some people come and they buy, you know, 20 things so they're prepared. But my goal as a business owner is to make it more accessible because I think that we deserve the opportunity to, you know, go and shop in person on the day of an event too. Like it shouldn't be that level of difficulty just to be able to celebrate authentically.
So that, I mean, I have so many thoughts about that. One and two questions, obviously. But my thoughts are, you know, That's one thing in general in terms of marketing for all different communities that are not mainstream, including the Black community, is, you know, I went to get something for my daughter the other day, and I went to a place that have a lot of monogram things, but her name starts with an L, and there was nothing with an L, and I was like, well, this is stupid. Like, there's no substitute for this. Like, I can't,
exactly.
you know, I'm not going to get something with the second letter. Like, this is the thing
right.
that I need. And
yeah.
that's the example that you just talked about, the mahogany line. Not only is the Black experience not homogenous at all, it's so, so varied. And when you can see something that represents you, very, like, as specific as possible, so that is magic. Like, that's magic. That's something that's really, really memorable. Greeting cards already are memorable. I've saved, like, special greeting cards for my entire life. So now I pack
Right.
them around with me from country to country that I moved to.
Yes.
And it's
We
something
all
that's
got that
really
card shoebox that we keep all
exactly.
important ones in.
It's such a special thing, and their format lends itself for, to, you know, save them forever. So
Yes.
That's definitely one thing that I thought about just immediately. When you go and you're trying to get something specific, and you have a card aisle that already is, like, fine, that's one aisle, and then within that aisle you have, like, a tiny, tiny subset of things, and as you said, maybe they're all have religious overtones or
Right.
whatever, they're catered to a certain
Yeah.
age or a certain whatever, and it's like, this is me but not really.
Exactly. And that's the thing. That's why, you know, my focus is about celebrating authentically, because we're going to celebrate regardless. Like, Black people, we love to celebrate. We love to have a party. We love to, you know, just tell people how, you know, amazing they are. Like, it's part of our culture. And I think that that's why, for me, it was super important to be like, okay, because we're such a celebratory, even in the darkest times, you know, like, and I think that that's why we're so big on celebrations, because we go through so much. So, you know, when it's time to celebrate a win, it's like, let's do it then. You know, a birthday is important. You know, we made it through another year. So to get a birthday card that is, like, bland or doesn't look like you, it's just like you said, you want to get something for your daughter. Like, it's important that, especially for young people, that's something that I've realized a lot now, you know, through my journey of becoming a mom in this company, is, you know, when my daughter has a birthday, I remember when I was a kid, all of my cards had animals or characters on them. There was never one with a kid on it, because they didn't make cards for Black kids. And when I had my daughter, I was like, oh, as on her first birthday, I'm looking at all these cards and I'm like, still characters, still animals, nothing with a Black kid on it. And then I made a card with a Black kid, because it's like, they need to see themselves. It's very important. Like, I don't think that, you know, and that's something that I really like about, you know, you were talking earlier about becoming, like, a children's book author or illustrator. I love how many books my daughter has with Black kids in them. I love that. I didn't have that growing up. And that's one of the areas where I've seen such progress be made. And it inspires me as a greeting card business owner to kind of follow what publishers and authors and illustrators have been doing in that area. And we see the impact that it has. Like, my daughter loves to read. She loves books. She's starting to memorize certain parts of it, and she's not even two yet. And I noticed that she has a big bookshelf full of books. She gravitates toward the ones that look like her. She likes the books that have Black kids in them more than she will go to the ones that have animals or characters in them. And I don't think that that's by mistake. So it's really important for us to, you know, make sure that we are continuing to, I think it's really important for us to see ourselves in an authentic way. Like you said, the more specific, the better, because it's about feeling seen without feeling like you have to hide or compromise certain parts of yourself.
My daughter, it's a, similarly to the books, I didn't have that growing up either. And my daughter has so many dolls that look exactly like her. And for me, that's amazing. I had one Black Barbie that my mom really had to work to find, and I had a Black Cabbage Patch doll, and that's it. My daughter has so many dolls. I think it's so amazing, and she loves her dolls. That's I think that's awesome. Talk to us about the first year of business. What did that look like?
My first year was interesting. I think it's very unique. So I started, like I said, July 2019. So my first year was, like, half non-COVID and then half COVID. And I started in the summer, and I started at an event. I did a pop-up marketplace, and it went really well. I sold out of my products. Everyone was really excited. And something that I noticed that is very important now, that I didn't pick up on that lesson right then, people loved the designs first and foremost. The sustainability was nice though. You know, I thought that the sustainability was going to be, like, the selling point, but it wasn't. People just loved the design so much. And at that point, I was So I think that the way that I took that was like, okay, I need to be more, my marketing needs to prioritize the sustainability aspect and that it's recycled paper and that it's made in the US. Like, I need to double down on it so people get that. But the more and more I did it, the more people just like, I love these designs. It's so great. This makes me feel seen. So, it took me a while to be like, oh, okay, the sustainability is there. Me doing it is not like whether people absorb or acknowledge it or not, it still has the same impact. So that was a lesson that I learned with like toward the end of that first year. And I'm still, simmering on now. Because like we said before, that was a big part of why I started the company and did things the way that I did. So as a business owner, it was interesting for me to, accept that, okay, just because this is super important to me does not mean that it's going to be super important to every customer, but that doesn't mean I have to change it. I can still do it, but what's going to get people excited is different. So that was something that I learned in that first week, really. Like, well, I started to see it, but I didn't absorb the lesson yet. But that was my very first few months was just, being at marketplaces and events as much as possible. And I was living in Brooklyn at the time. So I was doing a lot of events in New York, which was really great. And then I decided to move back home like 2 months into it. And so, yeah, I was back in Jersey, but still doing my New York events. Still working at my job in New York and doing my freelance, working a lot, like she
Oh my
said.
gosh. Oh my
Yeah, I was
gosh. You were working full-time freelancing and you were starting a okay.
So it was fun. I was a busy bee. And then I decided to quit my job in February of 2020 because like I said, I was doing a lot and the business started to build up so much momentum. I started to get DMs on Instagram from different retailers and like gift shops asking me if I did wholesale. And I was like, no, I have no, like, I
Oh
don't
my
have no
gosh, you were
idea.
getting requests for, you were, oh my goodness. Let's just put this in context also, just the timing. This was February 2020. You had been at it for less than 9 months, and this was like 1 month and a half before COVID hit. Okay, just so we're clear about the timeline.
So
And you were
all of these
getting
things.
messages from wholesalers. My
Yes, I
bad.
was getting from wholesalers asking me about this, and I'm like, okay, let me think about this. So at this time, I'm thinking like, okay, so I'm starting to get, this is February, so Black History Month, everyone's doing different initiatives and campaigns. So the what gave me that extra push was that I was getting these requests from corporate offices. They were doing a Black History Month activation during the daytime, and they wanted me to come in. And I'm like, okay, am I going to call out of work to go do this? Am I going to say no to this opportunity? Like, I have to weigh my options. And at the same time, like we said, I'm getting these wholesale requests. So I'm starting to see how much opportunity is with this business, but I couldn't do both because the job was very demanding. I was working at, an arts nonprofit. They want you to do a lot. It was a lot of work. So I was like, okay, I
This is
think I
true.
need to step away from this to give this a shot for myself. So
How
that's
did
what I
that
did. I was
feel, though? That decision. How did that feel?
It felt like I was doing the right thing. And I actually, the day that my last day of work, I recorded a video. It's on my Instagram. I recorded a video in my car, just like, today's my last day. I'm about to quit this job to go on this thing. And I don't know what made me do it, but I was like, I'm gonna record this for myself because if I get scared or if things get crazy, I need to remind myself of how I felt in this moment to remember that I'm doing the right thing. So yeah, I'm really glad that I do that and I rewatch it almost every year. And that it just passed again. So it was like February 13th. It was like the day before Valentine's Day. And I was telling, this is my Valentine's Day gift to myself. Like, I love and believe in myself enough to take this risk and like, make this jump. And yeah, so that's how I was feeling. I was feeling really good about it. And even when COVID happened, I was had all these events lined up for the spring. And then it was like, okay, everything's getting canceled. What am I gonna do? I was not discouraged, honestly. I was just very much like, okay, well, now I have time. I can sit at home. We can't go anywhere. Okay, I'll sit home and build out my website and sell online. People still have money. They want to buy things. They need cards. They can't go see their loved ones for Mother's Day. They
Gonna
can
be
buy a
sending
card,
cards
though.
even more. Yeah.
So yeah, I was definitely in a certain, because I was so early on in the journey, I was really excited and kind of driven still, even though kind of life was lifing around me.
Yeah,
I
for
realized
sure.
the opportunity that people needed this tool to help celebrate and acknowledge the people in their life more than ever at that time. So yeah, that's the, like I said, the first year was very unique because I went through all these changes and it was a great opportunity, for me to, take advantage of. And it went really well. I started to grow. I had a team at this point. Like in by March, I had hired someone to help me do sales and marketing, to help me with the wholesale pitching and things like that. Because like people are, if like even if only three people asked, that means that there's way more people that I can ask, So we
Yeah, those
started
are just the ones that took the time to come to you.
exactly. So we started a strategy for wholesale pitching. I had someone that was doing social media for me. So we were on Instagram heavy building out our community. We grew from like 5K followers to 20K
Oh my
by
goodness.
June. Yeah, it was a big leap. And we got our first inquiry. I think that was from Kohl's in like July of 2020. So
Wow.
coming up on our 1 year, we got our first big retailer request. So yeah, it was quite a ride. It was a very fast-paced growth, a lot of pivoting, but it was really important for me, I think, to have a first year like that, to build up that confidence, to know that like even if the world shuts down, you can still do this. Even if
That's
you quit
amazing.
your job, just a lot of it is having the faith and being willing to pivot. Like if I was so stuck on just like, well, no, I have to do events, like that was what my plan was, I would have been sitting in my house wasting
Yeah,
time
it
for
would
months.
have died right there.
Exactly. But that ability to pivot and just like, okay, let's go online, like that's just the natural next thing to do, and go into a whole start building those relationships with the wholesalers now, they'll open eventually and they're going to need inventory. So that was a really it was a really great first year. It hasn't all been great since then, but that first year was great. It was really good. And I got an office in July at my first year anniversary. I got out of my house and got my very first office space, and it felt
That's
really
a big
good.
deal.
It was a big deal. It felt
Yeah.
really good to like, okay, I got an established space where I can work out of. So yeah, it was a magical year, I will say.
So, what would you tell other entrepreneurs who are looking at, okay, do I need to leave my job now? This side hustle is turning real. Or even like, I can't build this on this. I need to, if I'm going to do this, let me do this. But they're maybe not as confident as you were at that time. What advice would you give them besides record yourself a video to watch every year?
Yeah, that is really important. You have to talk to your future self. I think that really is important in terms of, yeah, it's just important to be in communication with yourself, I think. So I've never given that piece of advice before, but it has been really helpful for me. So I would say to do that, be very intentional. Whether it's a video or a letter you write to yourself, entrepreneurship is very hard. So I don't like to give people advice about when to quit their job or when to, make that leap, because it's so variable. And, if I had my daughter when I was starting this business, I may not have quit. I can honestly say that. I didn't have anything to lose. I was like, okay, I moved back home. I'm living in my dad's house. I don't really have, too many responsibilities. It's just me. I can work all day and night if I need to. I can go hustle and do all this stuff. So it was just, it felt like I didn't have, yeah, it wasn't that risky for me at that moment in my life. So, but everyone's situation is different. Like if you have a family, you have a mortgage, you have, a lot of different things, your decision making is different. So I don't think there's one way to make that decision. I know some people say, oh, save up 6 months worth of expenses. I didn't do that when I quit. I had a feeling and I just went after it. So I think that it'll be very different for everyone, like when you're ready to make that leap. But I will say that you can never be fully prepared. I don't think there's ever a time in any, because it's risk. The definition of being an entrepreneur is taking on risk. So I think that that's when you'll know. When the risk that you have to take, you're comfortable with that. You acknowledge that this risk may not work out and you're okay with failing, in quotes, like failing is a part of entrepreneurship and risk is a part of it. So when you are at the place when you understand that, like, okay, if I make this leap, this is the risk I'm taking and it might fail, but I'm okay with that. I think that's when you're ready. And that point is different for everyone. And I understood the risks I was taking and I knew the potential for what it could be. And I was okay with, I kept telling myself, if I do this and it doesn't work out, I can always go back and get another job if I wanted to. And I have. A lot of business owners don't talk about that. I'm working another job right now. I've been a full-time entrepreneur for a long time, but then I do side gigs sometimes. I do freelance design on occasion. I've been teaching entrepreneurship for the past 2 years. That's been kind of my complimentary gig to my entrepreneurship journey. So yeah, I think that that's my main advice, is to know your risks and be comfortable with it. Be okay with failing and don't be afraid to get another gig or a side job if you need to keep it going. Just don't quit. That's what I've had to learn, pivoting and doing other things on the side, or the way that your entrepreneurship journey looks, it'll change. The way that I was in my office from sunrise after sunset. Like, I would be at my office until midnight in there with wine, blasting music, just like working before I had a kid because that's what I wanted to do. Now I'm not doing that. Sometimes I'm working, like right now, I'm working during the day. When I have to pick up my daughter from school, I stop. Like, I can't keep going because that's just not the way that my life looks. But when she goes back to sleep, I'm back at the computer because that's, you just have to make it work. And I had to understand that, the way that I worked before, it's going to be different in every season of entrepreneurship. The way that you approach it, there's going to be slow seasons. And I've learned to embrace that because when it gets busy, there's no letting up. So it's a very entrepreneurship requires you to be really agile and just flexible. So when you feel like you can be agile and flexible and take on that risk and not let it, break you down, then you're ready.
Yeah, I mean, this entrepreneurship is the for this is the hardest thing I think I've done, certainly professionally. I even think, having my daughter was more organic than entrepreneurship because, like you
I
said,
agree.
there's so many for you as well.
Yes.
There's so many hard pivots that you have to do when you're an entrepreneur, and that's it's for sure the hardest thing. Can you talk to us about the process of getting into Kohl's and just pitching to folks who are in a similar position, going to find wholesalers, pitching your product? What's that process?
Well, I always have to be very honest about the situation that my experience is very non-traditional because they all came to me. I didn't pitch to our major retailers. So Nordstrom, Kohl's, Macy's, Whole Foods, each of those partnerships came about because they've discovered us on social media or something.
Oh
And
my
they literally filled
gosh.
out a contact form on our website every time.
Oh
I would
my
just get a
gosh.
message through our contact form like, hey, we want to include you in this thing. Can we set up a call? And I'm like, okay, is this real? So
Congratulations.
thank you. We've been very lucky in that sense, but I think that that's a testament to just like how great our product is. That, when you are doing something that is truly unique and it's truly valuable, your customers will find you. So I think that that's what happened, that there wasn't really anyone that was doing what we were doing in
I was
terms
just
of,
going to say, you are obviously filling a space.
Exactly. That's exactly what it was. And I think that it speaks to like the product market fit. Like, we were creating a product and we're very specific. We weren't trying to serve everybody, but we knew who our market was. And that's why, these big retailers, when they're doing something for the holidays and they want to be inclusive, when they're doing something for Black History Month, when they're doing something for Earth Month, like, they know who to come to because, we check all the boxes, and not in a way that we're just, trying to check the box, but it's just authentically a part of who we are. So that's how we got all of those opportunities. But I always say it's about being ready. You have to be poised to take advantage of those opportunities. So what we did to take advantage of those things was, one, get a good mentor or somebody who has done it already. I talked to people who have been in retailers already who told me like, oh, you need to get a GS1 account so you can have barcodes. And I was like, what is that? They were like, okay, you might have to do EDI in order to have these orders received or submitted. You may need to, think about your fulfillment strategy. Are you going to be doing it on your own? Are you going to outsource? What's your supply chain like? Are you able to fulfill these orders? They're not going to pay you for 60 days. How are you going to front the cash to, do this? So having all of that information and the preparation to take advantage of it was, that's how I was able to successfully execute on all of those things. Because there are people who, may have gotten that opportunity and they had to say no because they didn't have the resources or, the time, or, they weren't prepared to take advantage of something like that. So I always tell, like, getting connected to someone who's a few steps ahead of you is so important to help you know what you don't know. I talk to people all the time when they ask me about retail. I always bring up GS1 because it's a very, like, it's a simple thing that, to people who are in the industry in retail know. But if you're not in that world, then you don't know that you need to get this account that costs you like $750. Like, it's a big investment for a small company. So if you know that ahead of time, and you can save up for it, or you prepare for it, when they come knocking for you to have this opportunity, then you have, those things in place.
Amazing. And how many in your channel strategy, how many distribution channels do you currently have?
So we have our own website on Shopify. We have an account on Faire for wholesale. We're on like three different drop shipping, like gifting platforms. And then I would say like we have corporate gifting, like custom. So yeah, I guess it's like six different platforms, but I'm always trying to, it's always changing. Because some platforms, if we try it out and then it's not really working, then we'll come off of it. And then I'm always trying to find more and more distribution channels. That's my lesson that I've learned in the past year, is that being too reliant on one channel is a setup for failure. And that was my lesson from last year. You know, we built a lot of our momentum and our sales based on our partnerships with Macy's and Nordstrom. Those were two of our big retailers for a long time. And, you know, we've all seen in the past couple of years how a lot of these big box retailers are cutting their own budgets. So that hit us where we didn't get orders from them last year. And I was like, oh, okay, I need to have a different strategy that's not so reliant on them, because that was the bulk of, you know, where I projected my sales. So always be expanding, or just, you know, even making it on your own channel. You know, D2C is so important because of, you know, that reason. You know, with greeting card industry, wholesale is usually where you default to, because people like to buy cards in person. So because we don't have our own physical location, I've been working a lot on building out our D2C strategy, because, you know, the wholesale is not sustainable, because you're at the mercy of someone else deciding to purchase from you for customers. So being in direct contact with the customer is super important. So yeah, if you're selling a product, I definitely think, you know, get on as many channels as possible, test them out. You know, if it doesn't work, you can always come off of it, but you have to explore the options. Because a lot of the channels that we're on that are really successful are ones that I have no idea about. They came to me, you know, pitching it, and I just explored it, and it ended up working out really well.
And how can, because a lot of our stores on B1 are physical locations, small, you know, sustainable grocery stores, refilleries, a lot of retail spaces. How can they get in touch with you if they're interested in making some, you know, smaller orders?
Yes. So Faire is like our primary platform. You can go on there, see all of our products, and Faire offers, we have a link to it on our website. On our wholesale page, you can go shop direct with us on Faire, and they give you, I think, for your first order, maybe like $100 off, or you have like net 60 payment terms, or you can order with us. We get our money immediately, and then you get a little time to pay Faire for it. So they're really favorable for small businesses. Yeah, I really like working with them. That's the best way to purchase. But if you want to shop directly with us, you can always send an email too. So yeah, I really like being in small gift shops. I think that the big stores are great for just like the volume orders, but being in small gift shops is where you get kind of that relationship building with the store owners. Sometimes they give really great feedback about like, oh, this sold really well, or people like this, or do you have this type of thing instead? And I love seeing the repeat orders come in. Like, we have some retailers that have been ordering from us for like the past 3 years. They're always coming back. We have a really great retailer that's in Bermuda, actually. It's called Long Story Short. She has a gift shop there. And I've had like three people who I know personally, they're like, oh, I was in Bermuda, and everybody kept telling me to go to this gift shop, and I saw your products in there. I was like, yes, they are great.
I don't think I
So
know
I love the small
anybody
gift
who
shop.
has vacationed in Bermuda, and you know multiple people. Wow. And they're in
Yes,
this store. Okay.
exactly. And they were saying, look, that gift shop is like the place to go in Bermuda.
Wow.
So I really like, you know, being able to put our products in like the best, or like the landmark stores in people's local communities. There's another place that I really love in LA. It's called Reformation. No, sorry. It's called Reparations Club. And it's like a bookstore, but they have lots of other merchandise and like vinyls and things like that. So we're a greeting card company that's in there, which is really great. It's another place in Houston called Kindred Stories, which is like
I've heard
all.
of, yeah.
Yes, Kindred Stories is great. They're one of our most loyal retailers. They're always placing an order like every 2 months. So that's like the momentum that I love. Like, okay, whoever's in Houston, they really love our products, because it is selling, it's going off the shelves. So I really like to see the data and things from, you know, how our products are performing on that small scale. Because in the big stores, it's hard to know like who's coming in. You know, the people who are buying the products are not the ones who are in the store selling them or talking to customers. So if you have a small gift shop, I would love to hear from you. Love to have your orders so that we can, you know, reach our community where they are.
Nice. All right. So we ask everybody a few questions that are always the same. What is the plan for 2024?
Plan for 2024. I'm going to be very bold about it. Okay. So
Speak
my
it
big
into
plan,
existence.
exactly. And this plan is very, it's the same plan. I have this plan every year, is to get into Target. That's my goal. And I keep saying it, because someone will listen and someone will help me get there at some point. We're getting very close. That's my big goal though, because the reason why I want to go to Target specifically is because people think we're already there. That's the honest truth of it. People come up to me all the time like, oh, I saw your products in Target. Like, no, you didn't. We're not there.
Not yet.
Are you sure? I've seen it. I'm like, no, you haven't. But I love that because we're manifesting it as a community. Everyone in the AYA community is manifesting our products being in Target because they belong there. It's, you know, this is where people go to get high quality products. They have the range, so many different locations. It would help us to reach so many more people in our audience who want to feel represented and seen. And I think that Target does have, you know, out of other retail, I think that they do have a really great program to try to encourage more diversity and that commitment to having Black owned businesses. And I'm starting to see a little bit of the sustainability too. So I would love to be a part of that push to help them, you know, have a sustainable brand in their, on their shelves. So yeah, that's what everything is working toward, you know, helping to, my big marketing strategy is creating that demand to help showcase to them from a data perspective, like Black community members want this product. People want to see us on the shelves. They think they already see us on the shelves. Mm-hmm. So you're leaving money on the table. So yeah, that's my big goal. So, you know, good. Leave a comment on Target. Let them know you want to see us on there. Leave a review on our website saying that, you know, where you want to see us. Let us know how what you feel about the products. That's my thing this year, is just like helping to create the demand, or not even creating the demand, showing the demand because it's there, and continuing to reach more customers because, you know, we've been in business for 5 years, but I don't even think we've tapped into like 1% of our potential market because it's so big, you know.
It's big.
It's a big market. People think that, you know, serving Black community is very niche, which like it is, but there's 13.5 million Black people in this country.
It's not.
And we're just talking about this country alone. We haven't even gotten into international. We don't do international shipping yet. So there's so much room for growth that's my focus for this year, is figuring out how we can reach more people where they are. How do we get more people aware that we exist? Because people have the problem that they can't find cards that look and sound like them. So how can we show more and more people that AYA Paper Co. is here and tell, come and buy our products and then tell everyone else about it and spread the joy authentically. So yeah, that's my high level plan for the year.
Nice. All right. I've got 3 rapid fire questions for you. Okay. What has been your biggest success to date?
Biggest success to date is continuing to operate. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, people always talk about a lot of businesses fail within the first 3 years and then even more in the first 5 years. So we're coming up on 5 years and I thought I was going to quit. Didn't think I was going to make it quite a few times. So my biggest success is still being here, still going.
I hear this a lot, talking to entrepreneurs, especially following last year, which was just horrendous for a lot of people, a lot of companies.
Mm-hmm. I thought I was going to, I had a full on mental breakdown, crying down the wall. Like, what am I even doing here? I don't know if I can make it. So the fact that I can now look back on it and say, "Oof, that was dramatic." I'm still doing it. It's okay. Everything turned out to be fine. It feels good to know that, you know, I kept going because, and it's not to, you know, look down on anyone who stops, but it's just like, you know, it feels really like success to me, even though it wasn't ideal. I didn't hit every single goal that I wanted throughout these 5 years, but I kept going. So that feels really good. That's what I'm most proud of.
Wonderful. Flip side of that, what is your biggest failure to date?
We, like you said, you know, 2023 was a very difficult year for a lot of business owners. And the years prior were the complete opposite. It was great. Business was growing. Everyone was, you know, doing really well. So based off that momentum, I was preparing for another big year. I bought all this inventory and, you know, prepared for all these orders to be flooding in. And then they didn't come. And I was stuck with all this inventory on my hands, looking at cash on the shelves. Like, I could have had this money in my account, but instead I got this inventory. And now what do I do? So that was a very challenging thing that I'm still dealing with. So I think that's why that feels like the biggest failure, because it's still something that I'm dealing with the consequences of. And it's a very common thing that happens in product-based businesses, you know, trying to project how much inventory to keep on hand is so hard. It's a very hard thing. So yeah, I wish that I could have avoided it by listening to some of my advisors, to be honest. You know, it's one of those things where as a business owner, you listen to your advisors and sometimes you take their advice and other times you say, no, I'm gonna take the risk because I think that, you know, it's your business. You know, at the end of the day, you know it better than anyone. So I thought that I knew this, and in hindsight, I could have waited because it's not like my products take forever to produce. That's what I have to remind myself now. Like I can literally get an order in a week, in 2 weeks. So
Well,
there's no reason for me.
now you know that for sure. In entrepreneurship, I
Exactly. And
feel
it's
like there's a
like,
lot of benefit to making some of your own mistakes.
exactly. You can only learn by making some mistakes on your own. You know, it's good to be able to avoid some of them, but sometimes you don't feel it, you won't learn it unless you really feel it. And now that I feel it, I'm seeing all of these boxes and I'm having the cash flow issues. It's like, oh, I will never use again.
And you will
Never. Like
never,
I feel
ever forget
the
this.
lesson. Exactly. So yeah, hopefully I can save someone from making that same mistake. Just like, no, what is your turnaround time? If it only takes you 2 weeks to get a new order or whatever your product is to prepare it, then all you need is 2 weeks of inventory, truly, you know, or if your timeline is 6 months, then all you need is 6 months worth, you know? So, you know, being more lean in terms of inventory is important. I think it's also the most sustainable thing because I'm not big on waste, so I'm not going to throw away my products. I have to make sure that they don't get damaged or anything in the time being. And luckily, my product is not something that expires. But for example, if you have a beauty product, something that people have to consume, it's even more important to be lean with your inventory because you don't want to have to waste things or throw things away because they didn't sell before the expiration date. So I think that thinking about the entire product life cycle, not in terms of like just where things end up, but how long it's going to take for it to end up there is so important. So it's definitely something that I failed at before, but I'm working on.
The most important lesson that you've learned today, if it's different to this one.
Most important lesson. Okay, so if you asked me this 2 years ago, I would say the most important thing is to not do everything alone. Because at that point I had a full team. I've from when I started the business until like last summer, I always had at least three people working with me. Sometimes as employees, sometimes as contractors, but I had someone to help me with like virtual assistant, email, correspondence, someone to help me with sales pitching, and someone to help me with marketing and email, social media. So like you said, last year is very hard. So I had to lay off my entire team last summer. And that felt so, it was one of the hardest things I've had to do. And, you know, anybody who has a business, who has a team, you know, we don't want to fire people. You don't want to take away people's, you know, income. But as a business owner, you also have to think about your own livelihood and your own income. So that was a very difficult thing that I had to face. And the lesson for me was that I can do a lot of things on my own. I think that I got very comfortable. Like I said, in my first year of business, I had a team. So I was obviously working very hard, but I had a lot of support and I was delegating a lot of things to other people. And part of delegating means that you're not getting the hands-on experience. So there were certain parts of my business that I was delegating or overseeing, but not hands-on. But in the past 8 months now, I've gotten like a crash course in a lot of this stuff because now I'm deep in it on my own. And I'm being forced to be more resourceful and trying to, you know, just being more, also being more of the public face of my company. So I think the biggest lesson, maybe just being uncomfortable. I think that's what it is. Being comfortable with being uncomfortable, because working on a big business on my own was not comfortable. Letting go of my team was not comfortable. Having to, you know, I started doing pitch competitions. So talking about my brand in a competitive sense to ask people for money was not comfortable. Starting to do podcasts and talking openly about my business was not comfortable. But by doing all these uncomfortable things, it's opened so many doors and opportunities that I could not have done if I wanted to stay in my comfort zone of delegating things and just, you know, still paying people when I didn't really have it. And, you know, just trying to make everything stay the same. It's very comfortable to have things be the same as you always know them. But this past year has taught me to just get uncomfortable because you don't know what's on the other side of that discomfort.
Now, that's something that I probably needed to hear today myself. So
See,
thank you
everything
for
is for a
that.
reason. I'm glad that I said that one then.
And what about if you could get 85% of the world to adopt a single behavior, what would that be?
To be more intentional with our consumption. And it's a very vague one. It's not like an easy thing, but I think that intention is really important in our day-to-day lives and not just buying things or yeah, just not buying things just because you can. We live, especially here in America, very consumption-based community. Like everything is about having more getting more things so that we feel better about ourselves. You know, we work so hard to get all this money and you want to have something to show for it. And I think that the desire to have something to show for all of our work can lead us to overconsumption and things that we don't really need, things that we end up throwing away and wasting. And that's something that I do my very best to, just be intentional about what I'm consuming and figuring out how can I maybe be more resourceful. Like, do I need to buy something new or do I have something else that can serve the same purpose? Do I need to buy something new or can I borrow this one thing from someone that I will only use this one time and then give it back to them? And I think that a lot of that requires community in a way that we don't really, that this world doesn't encourage, but resisting the urge to have an individualistic consumption-based approach to life. Be in community, reduce our consumption. And yeah, I think that's a tall order to ask 85% of the world, but I think that it's all relative, you know, what more intention in terms of my consumption, what being in community, what reducing, you know, my waste looks like for me is different from someone else. And I think that that level of flexibility or just like, you know, being aware of everyone's conditions is really important, because even the way that I consumed before I had a child is very different than now. It's very hard to be, you know, conservative in certain ways when you have a toddler. Like one of the examples that I always like to give is like, you know, being cognizant of people's situation is when I had my daughter. Well, before I had her, I never used like single use plates or cups, always dishes, always glass. I kept all my glasses and everything like that. I recently had to start buying paper plates. And it was not something that I took lightly. I really did not want to start doing it, but I was like, I'm going to drive myself crazy cleaning all these dishes over and over and over again for my toddler who wants five different things and is only going to eat one of them. Like, and I had to realize like, okay, where can I make another sacrifice? Where can I reduce my consumption in another area to make up for this? And that's what the intention is. It's not that you have to be perfect and not consume anything or follow some set of arbitrary rules, but I think it's just being aware of what the impact is of our choices and what we're consuming and how can we be, just being aware of it and trying to reduce it as much as possible, whatever that means for you. I don't think that there's one hard and fast set of rules that we all need to follow. But I think that if we were all more aware or just intentional and thinking about what we did instead of mindlessly just going and buying stuff, it could make a really big impact.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And last one, can you remind us where all we can find you and plug your socials, website, etc.? You don't have an IRL right now, but where can we find you?
So yeah, if you are in Newark and New York, that's where I am over here in the tri-state area. If you have an event or anything I would love to be a part of, you want to invite me, please feel free to reach out. My website is ayapaper.co, AYAPaper.co. Same thing on Instagram at ayapaper.co. Oh, my personal Instagram is simply.savonne, S-A-V-O-N-N-E. Follow us on TikTok also at Aya Paper Co. And if you want to shop with us, please visit our website and sign up for our newsletter. You can get 15% off of your first order. And yeah, I'm excited to see your orders come in. Excited to see you all in the real world. If you subscribe to our newsletter, you'll get updates about when we have events in the area. So that way you can come and meet me in person and see our products.
Nice. And then for everybody in the audience, let's go ahead and get Aya Paper Co. in Target. So we'll all do our thing.
Yes. Put that plug in their ear. Like I said, I'm collecting data. So the best data collection that we can do right now is just showing the increased volume of orders and showing, you know, where those orders are coming from. So if I can pull, you know, my analytics report and say, look, we had 20,000 orders come in the New York region, then that gives them a reason to at least test us out in this area. So wherever you are, place your orders, leave me a little note and tell me you listen to the B1 podcast and leave a review saying that you would love to see these on Target. That would mean the world to me.
Wonderful. Vaughn, thank you so much for talking to us about Aya Paper Co. and your journey and your future as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. This was great.
And everybody else, we will see you on B1.